Quite often we hear this term hyperventilation. And hyperventilation, it's pretty simple. Hyper meaning a lot or too much, and ventilation, the breathing activity. Hyperventilation is basically defined as more breathing than your body requires at that moment. And so your body, this is an interesting thing in that you're rolling along in life, just, you know, walking or talking or whatever, and you're actually sitting around somewhere between 96 and 98% oxygen saturated. So this means that, you know, a couple of breaths and you're 100% oxygen saturated. So what happens when you keep breathing? When you do hyperventilation, so it would look like this. Already getting a little dizzy. But this is what hyperventilation looks like. Or it could be simple. Long, slow, deep breath. So I don't need all that oxygen. And so I'm actually hyperventilating. So after your initial couple of breaths that will bring you up to 100% oxygen saturated, all you're doing is lowering your level of carbon dioxide. Your level of carbon dioxide gets lowered. Now the interesting thing, and what makes this a very important safety situation, is when you lower the carbon dioxide, you dispense or put off the actual trigger that makes you want to breathe. It's carbon dioxide. It's high carbon dioxide that actually gives you the urge to breathe. It also gives you contractions, the involuntary action of your chest, like this, you know, the contractions. Carbon dioxide caused, not low oxygen, high carbon dioxide. This is important to remember. Now think about it. Person goes up on the surface here, and believe me, this was taught. This was taught for many years, that one must hyperventilate before he dives. So you can think about it, you're on the surface and you're hyperventilating. And then you dive. Now, after the first couple of breaths, your levels of oxygen are at 100%. So now you've just lowered your carbon dioxide, got rid of more carbon dioxide, lowered it further. So now you've put your trigger to breathe further and further into the future before you get high levels of carbon dioxide in your bloodstream. Now you're on the bottom, say in 15 meters or something like that, and once again there's a fish giving you a bit of a run round, but you're feeling really good. Okay, you don't feel, you can, yeah, you know, I'm ready, you're down there, you're throwing a bit of sand up and not looking at the fish and doing all the stuff that we do that gets fish in. However, you're not getting the urge to breathe. Why? Because you've messed over your trigger. That urge to breathe triggered by your high carbon dioxide has not occurred. Now, if that urge to breathe comes too late to tell you to get to the surface and get some air, you're quite likely going to black out on the way. And many of the blackouts that occurred have occurred because a person's hyperventilated and the urge to breathe came too late. And when he comes to the surface, he got halfway or got to the surface even and blacked out and drowned. So, that's really simple. Don't hyperventilate. There it is, don't hyperventilate. You know, one or two, and I usually go, look, three or four long, slow, deep breaths, probably a little more than you need right at the moment, but brings you up to 100%, makes you feel okay, you're gonna be fine. It's 8 to 9, or, you know, what some people go, well, you hyperventilate, or you breathe for, you know, 2 minutes before you go down, and And many times in the past I've come across, especially some of the old school, and they hyperventilate for 2 to 3 minutes before they go down. So hyperventilation is a direction into trouble. What you also got to look at is that there's a reason why we tend to do it. And that reason is because it gives us a comfortable dive. It makes us feel good because you don't get this urge to breathe. You go down 30 seconds, you got this urge to breathe, you get a contraction, not comfortable feelings, but at least we know where we're at on it, you know? Hyperventilating, you go down there and you don't get that urge to breathe, and it's a comfortable dive. Now, final thing on the subject is that it has been tested and shown that hyperventilation does not give you a longer time before you black out. It actually gives you a shorter time. And the reason being is because you create a more alkaline blood by not having so much carbon dioxide in it. And the alkaline blood causes the hemoglobin, the protein that holds onto the oxygen, that catches and holds onto the oxygen, it causes the hemoglobin to hold onto that oxygen longer. It's the acid, the high acid, the carbon dioxide that's in the blood, causing the blood to become acid, that makes the hemoglobin release the oxygen. So hence you find that free divers will often go for their very first dive of the day as their best dive, because they will get the urge to breathe really quick, they will not hyperventilate, and they will release all the oxygen that they can from their hemoglobin in their blood. The tragedy of having this comfortable dive after hyperventilation is the fact that you will actually black out while you've still got a bit of oxygen in your blood. It's just not being released into the blood system so that you can use it. And that's the tragedy. So don't be afraid of the urge to breathe. Don't be afraid of the a bit of contraction, right? You know, use these to help time the dive. Use these to tell you when it's time to come back up, you know, so that you're always working within a safe level. You're always working at a safe level. Now we're looking at the blackouts, and we're also looking at something called a samba. Now blackout is very simple, the losing of consciousness due to low oxygen. That's what it is. And the oxygen level goes down and the body can't function anymore. Boom. Simple. It's like a fuse in a fuse board. Click, gone. Now, a person can black out just like that. Or a person could samba. And no one knows why one does the one and not the other. Some people go along, then all of a sudden, gone. Other people go along and they will have a samba. But what is a samba? A samba means loss of motor control. It's a colloquial term. And I think it comes from a dance, you know, doing a samba or something like that. You know, it's like a convulsion. A heavy duty samba, a strong samba, is like a big convulsion, uncontrolled. And it's basically, you know, there's not enough oxygen going through the system for the cells to talk to each other, to communicate with each other, and the body goes out of control. And a samba could look like this, you know. A samba could look like that or that, you know. Or quite often, it's just a shaking like this, you know, okay? Samba, loss of motor control, okay? And, you know, a samba often will go into a blackout, a personal samba, and then blackout, you know? But you don't have to samba. Some people just go click, gone. So those are the two definitions, blackout, loss of motor control, blackout and a samba, loss of motor control, okay? One of the areas that has to be handled to become a safe diver and a safe safety diver is recognizing when a diver's in trouble. So part of it is understanding, you know, say your diver's down there and he's down there for a minute and a half and you go, whoa, actually that's a big dive for him, you know. There, you're already, you know, you're already at the first step. Now you're really on, you're looking, you're checking where he is and what's up, you know. So part of it is understanding his abilities. But there are other things. For example, when a diver's coming up, and most of the problem a diver gets into is in the top 10 meters. There is a change of pressure. And you'll find about this, full details about this when you do a free diving course. So you have a change here from the surface, you've got one atmosphere. And then when you go down to 10 meters, you've got two atmospheres pressure. So when you're coming back the other way, at 10 meters with two atmospheres, you go up to the surface and it's one atmosphere. This is the biggest change of pressure in your entire dive, is that top 10 meters. This is why shallow water blackouts happen in that top 10 meters. And it's a, you know, you could check it out, shallow water blackout, things that you can study on this. Definitely do a freediving course, you'll find out much more about it. However, it's gonna happen. If it's gonna happen, it's gonna happen in that top 10 meters, most likely. Not all the time, but most likely. So you're watching the diver return to the surface, hopefully from the bottom if you can. If it's not, you're followed his line. He's going down here, you're keeping it so that when he comes up, he's coming up in front of you. In that top 10 meters, you're watching him. There are things that will tell you if he has, if he's having problems. You quite often will see him doing contractions, you know, and this is this part of the chest here, you know, trying to breathe, okay? And you'll see that for a start. But you can actually start seeing other things. A samba can occur at this point and you'll find that his body is going out of control or shaking or something like that. If a diver's coming up and just stops kicking, that's a major thing to look at. Now, occasionally a diver will come up and he'll see a fish and stop kicking and he's looking at this fish and going, well, yeah, I'm interested in that fish. That's probably not going to happen, you know, if he's been down there for a minute and a half or something like that. But if he's coming up and he's looking, you know, he's at the end of the dive and all of a sudden he stops kicking, you better get over there fast, wherever it is. If he's coming up and all of a sudden his kicking looks disjointed, and this is one of the first things happen, he seems to be kicking, but it's no longer making a move, you know. It's kind of like a little bit gone into a, you know, a different sort of an action that looks disjointed. That's a sure sign that there's a problem there. Coming up to the surface, quite often, a person will come all the way up to the surface, hit the surface, sometimes even get a breath, and then go under. So that's why we have to watch them when they hit the surface, and for, it takes about 10 seconds for blood, for oxygen as you've taken into your lungs to hit the blood and get through to the brain. It takes about 10 seconds. So at that point, you've got to watch for at least 10 seconds after that first breath to make sure he's okay. It will look, person comes up, the head comes out, he may get a breath, quite often he won't, and then he'll just go, and the water will come down. Sometimes you get to there and you go, well, what's happening? You know, well, you've got to realize that that is the sign. And we train in the pool, once a person brings the airways out, to keep them out. And if we're walking along the pool and someone's airways pop out and they pop back on, we see it like that because we've trained ourselves to watch those airways. So this is something that you can do as a spearfisher. When those airways come out, if they go back down under, you're on them. Okay. Quite often divers get out there and they'll start signaling to each other they're okay. But don't be fooled. It's quite possible for a diver to come up and go, okay, and then go blub, 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 blub as he goes into a samba or something, you know. So it's your observation that could save his life. If he gets a lung, even if you get over there a bit late and he gets a lung full of water, that can be a major problem. A lung full of water, he needs to get to the hospital, okay. You know, if he's coughing a little bit, not such a big deal, but if he's definitely got a serious amount of water in there, you better get to the hospital. He could get secondary drowning. Secondary drowning is the case where you've got salt water, especially salt water, but also happens with fresh, in the lungs, and you might have coughed it out and you're being fine and you've come around and things like that. However, the body has a reaction to the entry of foreign water in there, especially salt water, and it draws water from the body and fills the lungs. And this is what secondary drowning is, and it's enough to take your life. So if you've got a serious amount of water in your lungs, when you're diving, get to the hospital and tell them what the story is and you're just concerned about secondary drowning. It's a vital thing as a diver to be able to handle blackouts. And you know, it's all very well, okay, just get them and grab them, hold them, you know. If you haven't done it and you haven't got used to it and you might have a couple of waves breaking around you or something like that or whatever, and you're not used to handling a body that's now limp and the head's flopping around or something like that, you better drill it, okay? Because there's nothing, you know, something like competence on something, being able to handle something, drill it, to turn something that's an extreme thing into a very handleable thing, you know? It's like if you're trained at it, it's easier to handle. But if you're not trained at it, it's a panic. I remember in friends of mine were diving wrecks in Gladstone. And they were 30 meter wrecks, and these guys were quite young. And I remember hearing about this, and they were my friends, and I went, okay, so I got a video, you know, and sent it to them and told them, you know, this is a video called Sambas and Blackouts, done by Erez Betis. And we filmed it at the club at the time, and I did the editing, and I sent this video to them. It's about how to recognize and handle sambas and blackouts. Okay, so these guys got this video, and then I spent some time on the phone with them and basically worked out systems for them to dive. And they continued diving, and we thought, okay, that's fine. However, they watched this video numerous times, and they, you know, worked over these practices and drilled them. And then one day, one of them stayed down there a bit long and came up and had a blackout. These guys were practiced. They weren't like even drilled by someone like myself or someone who had done a fair bit of it, but they had gone through it and worked out ways and systems of doing it, and they handled it. Saved his life, they were ready for him, they were watching him, they did everything right just because they were educated. So this is the importance of you as a spearfisher, as a freediver, to be educated on how to handle these emergency situations. So we're not going to do that right now, but you need to go to get a freediving course. You can get one at ADRENO. You can and start studying and start drilling. Look, most of the freediving clubs in Australia, part of their induction is to drill handling blackouts and sambas. So you can get this information in many different places, but you need to have this information and you need to drill it. And their safety and your own safety depends on your ability to handle these situations. So that brings us to the end of this title, Freediver Safety. So remember, the most important thing is diving with a buddy and having the buddy responsible and actually doing what he should be doing. And probably the bottom line of this is communication. Okay, I'm gonna dive here. It's 20 meters. It's a deeper dive than I'm used to doing. You let your buddy know. And you keep your communication line between you and your buddy always alive with what you're doing, so he understands or you understand what he's doing, etc. This is very important, you know. This is the bottom line. If you don't have that communication in, something will be missed. You know, even training in a pool, in a swimming pool, we have to do the same communication. We've got to know what the person's doing and be prepared for anything. And this is your attitude as a safety diver, as a dive buddy for your spearfishing friend. You've got to be ready. Okay, thank you.
Thanks for watching. If you've enjoyed the video, be sure to subscribe and turn on notifications so you don't miss a video. You can check out more content on our YouTube channel. Visit one of our stores and shop online at www.spearfishing.com.au.